here, but let's work backwards and start with that drive. David Montgomery, throughout the game, had moments, but not the momentum we saw in overtime. Do you think that was, I don't want to say a strategic approach by Dan Campbell, but recognizing the fresh legs and going to them?
There you have it, fresh legs, because leading up to the last moments in the fourth quarters offensively for Detroit, it was Jahmyr Gibbs in the backfield. He was getting the opportunities running the football and, of course, in the passing game as well. And then when we saw an extra period available, that's where you saw the battling ram in the ball game, the bell cow, and David Montgomery. And you talked about what he did. I mean, he had, 40-plus yards in that overtime drive. A field goal to be the ending result, which would have given the Rams an opportunity to either put points on the scoreboard also. But for them, it was like, no, we have one option and one option only, and that's scoring a touchdown, and we're going to do so the Detroit Lion way.
An impressive drive, and to your point, that looked like the Detroit Lions were at times looked to be a team searching for what they wanted to get to offensively. We know what the LA Rams are going to be offensively under Sean McVay. It's going to be pass to set up the run, but this felt a little bit out of whack on this day. 23 rushes to 49 passes, and it really came to light in those final 4 minutes when they were unable to salt away the clock. Now, you do run the ball with Kyren Williams, and he goes out of bounds, but a couple pass attempts that did stop this clock late in this game. Play clock and game management is usually the knock on the other sideline when we talk about these two teams. What did you make of Sean McVay's handling of the final 4 minutes?
I felt like Sean McVay was pressing. Yes, Detroit had a lead, but it wasn't like it was a double-digit lead. You know, coming out of halftime, you talk about being down 7 points, 10-3 was the halftime score. They never devoted themselves to the running game. And I said during our pregame show, the thing I love about Sean McVay, he relies on the running game to open up passing opportunities, especially with the play-action pass. But watching how he called the ball game, especially in moments where they fought right back in this ball game, it was all throw. He wanted to rely on the arm of Matthew Stafford. I don't know, was it about proving a point, Matthew Stafford back in his old stomping grounds there in Detroit? But when you look at how they've done things in past opportunities, the ground and pound attack has been very, very influential in what they do offensively. And I felt like Sean McVay was just pressing. Like, to your point, that last drive, you want to make sure you work as much clock as possible with all intent trying to get positive yards to be able to get into scoring range. They were pressing. They left too much time on the clock that led to a game-tying field goal for the Detroit Lions that led to a walk-off game-winning touchdown by the Detroit Lions in OT.
Felt like there were a ton of strands we could pull at coming out of this game. The reemergence of Cooper Kupp with his running mate in Puka Nacua going down looked like the Cooper Kupp of nearly triple crown lore that we saw a couple years ago. The interior of that LA team. And these are two teams in the NFC that are going to be players throughout the season. It seemed that way. Am I walking away from this game feeling something wrong that, yes, we get an outcome and we had to have one way or the other, but these are two teams that are going to be right there in the conversation when we get into week 10 of this season trying to figure out who's going to be our playoff teams.
Yeah, for the LA Rams, yes, you lost, but this was a growing opportunity for the Rams, especially on the defensive side, Joe, because they have a lot of young studs on their defense. I talked about what type of production or what kind of production will they get not having Aaron Donald in place in the interior. We saw different individuals get an opportunity to showcase what they can do. We saw flashes here and there, but it was a growing opportunity. And then when you look at the Detroit Lions, anytime these two teams face off, it's going to be a very, very competitive like game. This is the type of, most importantly, you won. But you were able to do so without Amon-Ra St. Brown being impactful in the offensive game. You was able to do so without Sam Laporta being impactful in the offensive game. That is a plus, because at some point in time, they're going to come to the party and they will come with drinks and potato chips, right? But because they didn't come to the party, another player came to the party, and Jameson Williams, who showed up. So now, those were big questions about Detroit offensively. Who can be the new number two? Remember, Josh Reynolds is no longer there. He's with the Denver Broncos, if I'm not mistaken, the number two wide receiver from a year ago, Reynolds. Now, Jameson is here. He's healthy. And that speed that he showcased while playing for Alabama is still there. It's still in place. And he can be that impactful splash-like player for this offense, especially when you have other guys like Sam LaPorta and Amara St. Brown.
There are 1,000-yard receivers on that offense. Just can't get all 1,000 in week one. A slow start there for Amara St. Brown, but a start in the win column for Detroit as we take a look at the side-by-side of these two quarterbacks. And letters matter. W's and L's, not numbers, but when you take a look at them, week 17 for Staff. Now his ninth week one performance with 300-plus yards. Sustained greatness in the passing game for Stafford. 217 on 28 attempts for Jared Goff. A down week in terms of passing league-wide. League-wide average passing yards for quarterbacks right around 190 across all starters on Sunday. So rating more yards on the Stafford side of the conversation, but it's going to come with nearly 50 attempts. And it comes in a loss. Jared Goff and the Lions in the win column early. Conversation continues here following this Sunday nighter, Mac. And
yes, sir.
I can't help but look at some of the numbers coming out of this game. And then you look at the holistic approach of it all, and LA's last two games have both been in that building and both come in losses. As you're trying to stack yourself up across an entire season in the NFC, these two being hopefuls, does that start to live in the back of your head that if we got to go there again, we've been there twice recently and it hasn't gone our way?
No question. I think that's why games like tonight, they matter when you talk about being in the same conference, because you don't know how a game in week one or week two, week three will play a major, major part when it comes to playoffs. You know what I mean? So seeing how Detroit, they've been able to find a way to win the last two recent matchups against the Rams is something that could be concerning moving forward if these two teams were to face off again in the same stadium there in Detroit. But most importantly for me, I think the difference between these two teams, Detroit has more experience on the defensive side, and they're more balanced on offense. You know, and we didn't really see Sean McVay try to establish that balance with the running game. But in overtime, we saw Detroit devote themselves to the running game. And when you talk about being in this atmosphere playing against good on good, you just can't be one-dimensional. We saw a one-dimensional-like approach for the Rams, relying on Matthew Stafford's play 60 arm, as I alluded to during that pregame show. But that's not the best recipe for success, especially when you're playing against a team like the Detroit Lions.
It's like a pitcher with a live arm. You think one year he's going to show up and that velocity is going to start falling off? And
yeah.
Still made a couple unbelievable throws off platform, did Stafford in this game, albeit it did come in a loss. These two, again, hopeful to be there when it's all said and done in the NFC. But one of the questions coming into this game on the LA side is, how do you supplement the pressure on the A-gap that's lost in the form of what
the issue for the Rams? They kind of fatigued out a little bit when you talk about playing this first ball game. And that has been the case throughout the NFL week one with a lot of starters, you know, not in football shape. You didn't really play a lot in preseason, so you're trying to get things going within the flow of the ball game. But in the latter moments of this ball game, we saw the Rams defensively speaking kind of fatigue out a little bit, and we saw the Detroit Lions exploit those opportunities when it came to one team looking a little tired, the other team having the energy. But I think the Rams, they're going to be okay.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? When you talk about this is a team that has been able to do more with less over the last few seasons. Heck, outside of Aaron Donald, most people couldn't name another defender on the defensive side. But that team made plays and got into the playoffs. I expect the same thing, even though Coach Raheem is no longer there. They have a new coaching regime on the defensive side. The mentality is still there, just like their head coach and Sean McVay. They're going to be okay. They need to get healthy, most importantly, and stay healthy, but I think they're going to be okay. They play against one of the best teams, so let's keep it real, in the NFC, and they took them down to the wire with a lot of young dudes making their first NFL game on the road, and they didn't waver. They just didn't have enough to get it done.
They're going to win a lot of games, but here's the tip. Stay out of overtime. Now 1-4 in OT under McVay. Numbers are the numbers.